I'm going to talk about a failed supernova explosion which has resulted in a weird white dwarf heading out into the depths of space. Okay, so a paper came out on the 20th of June, so relatively recently. Here it is. SDSS, and then the long telephone number that tells you what the star is. The partially burned remnant of a low-mass white dwarf that underwent thermonuclear ignition, question mark. So I think we need to back up a little bit and talk about, so this is a white dwarf star, and it's associated with a particular type of supernova, I think called a type 1A supernova, very famous type of supernova because it's used as a standard candle, something which is the same brightness wherever you see it. So it's used for cosmology, where we can actually use it and figure out how far things are away from how bright it appears. The reason why it's a standard candle is because of the mode, the way in which it explodes. And essentially what happens is you have a white dwarf, which is a very compact star. It's held up only by the pressure of quantum mechanics, effectively. Always the question with a star is why it doesn't just collapse under its own gravity. When it's burning nuclear processes in its core, that provides the energy source that keeps it up. But at the end of its life, that goes away and the star will collapse. And so, for example, for a white dwarf, it'll collapse right down to something about the size of the Earth. At that point, these weird quantum mechanical effects kick in and stop it collapsing any further. But what can then happen? There is a maximum mass for which that effect will work, a thing called the Chandrasekhar mass. And if you keep adding in some way more and more mass to the star, eventually you're going to approach that mass and there's a danger that the thing will collapse further. And actually all sorts of turmoil will occur within the white dwarf star. It'll become very convective. It'll become very disturbed inside. That's the point at which white dwarf is in danger of actually exploding by firing off a whole bunch of new nuclear, thermonuclear processes, but in a very uncontrolled way. And so it will essentially explode like a bomb. Interestingly, the views on this have changed. It used to be thought that when a star tipped over that magical Chandrasekhar mass, that was the point at which it blew up as a supernova. It's now thought it never quite gets to that mass, but as it approaches that mass, as I say, it becomes very disturbed, stirs up, very energetic processes can start happening, and something then kicks off these nuclear explosions within it. So then the question is, well, why would a star be putting on weight? Where's its extra mass coming from? And in order for that to happen, there has to be another star nearby to kind of donate the extra mass. And so it's probably in systems where there's a binary. You've got two stars orbiting each other, and one of them is donating some of its mass to the white dwarf. And so eventually it reaches to this point where these runaway nuclear processes occur and it explodes.
So it's sort of skimming matter from its next door neighbour.
It's sufficiently close to it, it's actually ripping the mass off it. It's, you know, its pull of gravity becomes stronger than the pull of gravity in the star that was holding onto that matter to start with. So it's literally ripping off the outer layers of its neighbouring star and acquiring them for itself. Usually that process is thought to be sufficiently disruptive that there's nothing left at the end, that the star just literally blows itself to bits. The interesting case here is that here there is still a white dwarf left, but it has some weird properties. And in particular, when they studied the spectra of it, so when they split the light up into the colours of the rainbow and looked at the sort of signature of the different chemical elements, they found some of those heavier elements that are made in the supernova explosions. So it looks like some sort of thermonuclear process has occurred with this white dwarf, but it clearly hasn't been quite as destructive as it usually is because there's still a white dwarf left at the end. And the other interesting thing is that the nuclear processes haven't gone all the way to the sort of end state that they usually do. Usually you end up producing, you know, so the carbon in the white dwarf ends up producing silicon, and the silicon turns into nickel, and the nickel turns into iron. There's a whole series of nuclear reactions that go on, and those produce all the elements up to iron. The interesting thing about this white dwarf is it doesn't have those heaviest elements in it. It doesn't have iron in it. It doesn't have nickel in it. So it looks like the process was sort of incomplete. It didn't destroy the star, and it didn't go through all the nuclear reactions that these things usually go through.
So it's like a failed supernova.
It didn't quite fail. Clearly something pretty dramatic happened to it, but it didn't quite go all the way. So it sort of, yeah, it didn't quite detonate completely. It was an incomplete detonation. The other interesting thing about it, this particular star, is they can measure its speed. You can measure the Doppler shift to tell you its speed along the line of sight, but actually there are also proper motion measurements for it. There are also measurements of its changing position on the sky. So they know how fast it's going. And it's going around the wrong way. It's not orbiting around the Milky Way in the same direction as most stars are. And on top of that, it's going at about 200 kilometers per second. So it's going along at a pretty rapid rate, which suggests that whatever the explosion process was gave it a pretty big kick. So it's now traveling at high speed. This again is a sign of something to do with probably the fact that it was in a binary system to start with. It'd be nice to think that, you know, it was just some failed explosion that kicked it enormously. But it turns out that that probably isn't enough to give it the speed that we see. But what is enough to give it the speed we see is if it was in a binary system and the explosion was sufficient to unbind the binary so that the two binary stars were no longer bound to each other. Because if, for example, this was a white dwarf that was orbiting another white dwarf, they can get very close together, which means they're actually travelling around each other at hundreds of kilometres per second. And so if you then suddenly take one of these white dwarfs away, the remaining one will then just keep travelling at that several hundred kilometres per second. So it looks like it was probably in a very tight binary, probably with another white dwarf star. This incomplete explosion occurred because it had ripped enough of the material from the other white dwarf to create a partial explosion. And that disrupted the second star probably almost completely. And so this first star then shot out into the Milky Way.
But the one that's shot out is the one that underwent the supernova of sorts.
Yes. Yeah, the other one was probably, it might have been destroyed completely in the explosion just because it got caught in the blast, or it might still exist. It might itself also be flying off in some other direction. There's really no way of telling.
So we don't know where the other, like the brother is.
No clue at all.
So the one that's firing off, that we do know about, the one that's firing off into the depths of space, it's not just the recoil from the explosion, it's to do with the kind of uncoupling from the gravitational interaction.
Exactly. It's almost certainly to do with the fact that most of the speed we're seeing is the speed that it originally had in its binary system, but suddenly that binary doesn't exist as a binary anymore, so it's just flying out into space. So there's a couple of interesting implications of this. One is that this type of explosion, so the reason why we typically see supernovae isn't because of the original explosion, it's because those explosions produce lots of radioactive material which then subsequently decays, and over the weeks and months that follow we see the energy that's being released from those nuclear decay products. The main nuclear decay product in type 1a supernovae is nickel, and of course this one never got around to making any nickel, so it wouldn't have had any material to go through this decay process, which means that if we had been around when the supernova occurred, it probably would almost certainly weren't, it would have been in the very distant past. But if such supernovae do go off, you probably wouldn't see them, because unless you happen to be looking at just the right moment when the flash occurred, then you wouldn't see it, and then there isn't that then slow subsequent decay that would allow you to catch the explosion later on. The second sort of slight warning here is this, you know, the simple story we usually tell about type 1a supernovae is they're all the same and it's very straightforward and that's why we can use them as standard candles. There is at least a little bit of a warning here that says actually sometimes weird things happen and you get incomplete explosions or different kinds of explosions. So it does mean we have to be a little careful if we're going to be using type 1a supernovae as standard candles.
Mike, you refer to this remnant that's barreling through the Milky Way as a star. Is it still acting like a star? Is it undergoing nuclear processes and emitting light? And
I mean, it's still emitting light because it's still hot. But it's still a white dwarf star, so it's still held up by its degeneracy pressure. It's not got any new nuclear processes going on in it. So it's a question of whether you count white dwarfs as stars or not. If you think a white dwarf's a star, then this thing's still a star. If you think it's just the remnant of a star, then I guess at this point it's just the remnant of a star.
Mike, if this is a common process and this happens a lot, would we have seen them before now? Like, should we consider this an oddity, or is it possible these things are everywhere?
I mean, they are relatively faint, so maybe we don't find, you know, we don't find all of them necessarily, and maybe we haven't studied all stars in sufficient detail. But I think what this is probably telling us is this is a kind of a rare process. And if the story I've told you is right, that it originated in a pair of white dwarfs that were sufficiently close to each other that one was actually ripping material from the other, and at some point one of them underwent a kind of slightly failed explosion, it's probably a fairly unlikely scenario. So I suspect there's probably not a huge number of them out there, but we really don't know at this point.
It sounds quite exciting though, doesn't it? The idea of a white dwarf, like, you know, barreling through the Milky Way on this sort of cannonball run.
It's sort of running from the scene of the crime as well, actually, right? It's clearly, you know, it's just survived this massive explosion and is now heading off as fast as it can.
Did this finding excite you? Like, do these things still surprise you?
Absolutely. In fact, so you told me about this paper. I didn't know about this paper, or at least you pointed me towards a newspaper article about it. which got me to read the paper. It's not my usual, you know, I usually do galaxies. I don't do white dwarfs and supernovae and things. But the more I read about it in the paper, the more interested I got in it, because it's clear this is a very intriguing object.
Star clusters, or if they were galaxies. And if they're galaxies, then that's something really, really interesting, because it's not clear how such a dense galaxy could form.
Which is really, really quite nice. It's not a very impressive image, but this is the first image that New Horizons took before it went on to take images of Jupiter when it flew past Jupiter, and then images of Pluto, and now even images of an asteroid in the Kuiper Belt as well.